We're at the Human Engineering Research Laboratories, which is a joint effort of the University of Pittsburgh, the UPMC Health Systems, and the VA Pittsburgh Healthcare System. And it's actually a collaborative effort of a number of investigators and faculty members and students and staff members, with the focus of trying to improve wheelchairs and related technology for people with disabilities. I guess one of the things that motivates us is that I'm in a chair myself, and I have a lot of friends who are in chairs. I'm active in the Paralyzed Veterans of America, and I'm active in various other consumer organizations. And so you learn, you talk to your friends, and you learn what their problems are. And what motivates us is one is that when we first got started doing this research, even before this when I was a student, one of the things I noticed was that some of my friends developed upper extremity pain and a back pain and had a lot of problems as they got older, and others didn't. And so they thought there must be a reason that some people do and some people don't. And interestingly enough, the studies really show that the key factors for successful aging with a disability are really level of education, age at onset of disability, which typically younger people do better than older people when they become injured, and their participation in the community, typically measured by either paid or volunteer work. The other category is how focused they are on health, so how careful they take care of, take care of yourself. So we've been developing recreational devices as well, so arm cycles and exercise sports wheelchairs and racing wheelchairs and different types of, and now we've got into helping to develop and commercialize exercise equipment that would be used in either physical therapy gyms or maybe even something like your common gym on the corner. We try to be a fairly comprehensive lab in wheelchairs. I guess the whole idea was that when you have didn't seem to be any lab in the world that covered all aspects from design to testing. So we've structured our laboratories around that. We have an open laboratory environment. What I mean by that is that no one faculty member owns a laboratory. So the projects move through laboratories as the resources of those laboratories are needed. And that helps facilitate the transfer of projects as they evolve. So we have a prototyping and a machine shop where we can design and actually manufacture in small quantities, either entire wheelchairs, but either electric powered wheelchairs or manual wheelchairs. We can do the entire range. And we can also make test machines or instruments for experiments or fixtures or components. Then we have a destructive test laboratory, which as an engineer, that's always kind of a fun thing. Most of the time most people sort of focus on the non-destructive testing as part of the manufacturing process, where we're interested in environmental abuse or in environmental wear. We're interested in just the wear and tear from long-term use of wheelchairs, sort of life cycle cost analysis. One of our emphasis for a long time has been trying to move people away from thinking about the initial purchase price and looking at the cost of a wheelchair over its life. So a maintenance cost, it's a replacement cost, how long it'll use. And then we've also created laboratories to look at secondary issues to wheelchair use, such as the upper extremity pain and injuries, some carpal tunnel syndrome, shoulder injuries, elbow injuries, and are common among long-term manual wheelchair users. Somewhere between 50% and 70% of long-term manual wheelchair users will go on to develop upper extremity pain. That upper extremity pain can be severe enough that it requires transition from a manual chair to an electric-powered wheelchair. That transition can be rather severe because now you need to make vehicle modifications and home modifications, and might have to modify your workplace or school, and cascade, and then so it's much more important if we can prevent it than it is to try to address it after the injury occurs. Some of it may also be due to the wheelchair design itself, and that could be the design of the seating system, the design of the back support, the design of the cushion, or the design of the wheelchair, how the wheelchair is set up, or where the wheelchair is used. For example, the sidewalks that you drive over, curb cuts and ramps and things like this. So that got us to study, develop the instrumentation and develop the protocols and to work with consumers to study that as well and to look at, are there ways that we can improve the wheelchair and are there ways that we can improve the environment? By improving the wheelchair, we're looking at things like suspension systems, evaluating what's a good a cushion, what cushions are best at reducing ride shock and vibration, which back supports are best at reducing ride shock and vibration, so that that data can be combined with sort of the static pressure mapping data. Also then to look at the environment, the built environment, and how should ramps be designed, and how should curb cuts be designed, and how should accessible sidewalks be designed. I think one of the important features of our lab is that we don't want to develop things and test things and design experiments to relate it to secondary injury without seeing that information translated both into changes in clinical practice, changes in reimbursement, and changes in what in services and products available to the consumer. That's because that's the end goal. That's really the measure of whether you're successful or not, not whether you got another grant or another paper published. It's the impact in those three areas. The automotive industry is something that's been approaching our group more frequently recently because we have a lot of knowledge that they can share from too, and you get transfer of knowledge in both directions because wheelchair users sit in their chairs 12, 16 hours a day. That's a lot of knowledge about seating and comfort and how people want to be postured. It can be applied to how cars are designed. So you get feedback in both directions. That, I think, is going to be where the breakthroughs are going to come. And I think that medical advances, advances in changing in society's attitudes towards people with disabilities. I mean, and I can now fly and rent a car and travel. And so those things where technology's gotten easier. And we're trying to do that for power chair users, too. And eventually, if I get to the point where I can no longer effectively use my manual chair, then I want to have power chairs at that time to allow me to do everything I can do today.